Hello everyone. In this webinar, we shall learn monitoring of sick newborn. The objective of this presentation is to learn to document baseline clinical status, to learn to identify any change from baseline, and this would lead to delivery of care which is safe and quality based. The clinical monitoring starts as you approach the baby. It is based on what you see and what you hear. You must make the most of your observation. And this observation has to be structured observation. And this involves doing a rapid CBC using a no-touch technique. The CBC stands for consciousness, breathing, and color. The purpose of this rapid initial assessment is to quantify the well-being of this newborn. Is it well or sick? Is it stable or unstable? Or is there a life-threatening event? Let's look at CBC in detail. The C of the CBC of our initial impression stands for consciousness. And consciousness gives us an information of perfusion of the brain. A baby who is awake, alert, and active has normal sensorium. However, if the baby is drowsy or non-responsive, it has an abnormal sensorium. Assessment of the cry is equally important. A baby who has a high-pitched cry tells you that there is raised intracranial pressure. A cry is a call for help. It tells us that there is a possibility of underlying hunger, pain, or hypoxia. And last but not the least, an absent cry is ominous. And therefore, in short, the consciousness is giving us a window to the brain and thus is of help to assess the intactness of the central nervous system. The observation of B, that is breathing, takes into consideration what is the rate of breathing. Is it fast? Is it slow? Or is it absent? We also need to note the work of breathing. Presence of chest indrawing, suprasternal indrawing, flaring of L in his eye, or a shallow respiration is abnormal and tells us that there is increased work of breathing. Note for any audible sounds. A stridor is suggestive of an upper airway obstruction. A grunt suggests an alveolar pathology. Thus, the assessment of breathing tells us whether the lung function is normal or the lung function is abnormal. And we must always interpret the respiratory status taking into consideration the sensorium. Increased work of breathing with normal sensorium tells us that there is respiratory distress. Increased work of breathing with abnormal or worsening sensorium tells us that there is impending respiratory failure. So just on observing the breathing, a lot of information can be gathered about the well-being of the respiratory function. Let's look at C, and that is the color. A pink color is telling us that there is adequacy in terms of thermal care and adequacy in terms of cardiorespiratory function. A pale skin tells us a possibility of a cold stress or impending shock, where a dusky extremity tells us a possibility of again a cold stress or an underlying cardiac disease. Anytime we notice duskiness, we must look for duskiness or bluishness in the mucous membranes to look for central cyanosis. And a crying which worsens the cyanosis tells us that there is an underlying cyanotic heart. Having done a rapid CBC, let's move on to assessing the vital parameters. Temperature forms the foundation stone for the care of a sick newborn. And therefore, all newborns must have assessment for thermal well-being. Babies nursed under warmer must be assessed for the skin probe being appropriately placed, and one must note the mode in which the radiant warmer is set. In the first week of life, for all newborns, one would ensure that the baby is under servo control mode set at a temperature of 36 degrees Celsius. One must also note the heater output. Despite the baby being under a radiant warmer, it is a good practice periodically to assess for temperature in the axilla. The target temperature is 36.5 to 37.5 degrees Celsius. In absence of thermometer, touching the trunk and the extremities gives us an idea of approximation of thermal well-being. Normally, when we touch the trunk and the extremities, they are equal in terms of temperature. However, if the extremities are cold and the trunk is warm, we make a diagnosis of cold stress. And if the trunk is cold and the extremity is also cold, we make a diagnosis of hypothermia. Mind you, this all needs to be confirmed again by means of documenting the temperature by means of thermometer. At any time you document a temperature difference between the core and the periphery of more than 3 degrees Celsius, it has to be taken as secondary to infection unless proved otherwise. Let's look at the heart rate. The heart rate is normally in the range of 120 to 160 beats per minute. A heart rate which is less than 100 indicates bradycardia, and the commonest cause of bradycardia in the newborn is hypoxia. A heart rate which is more than 160 beats per minute suggests tachycardia. It could be because of crying, fever, anemia, shock, sepsis, drug toxicity, or an underlying rhythm disorder. It is equally important to note that even if the heart rate is in the normal range, a change in baseline heart rate of more than 20 beats per minute is abnormal, and one would need to find an underlying cause. It is equally important that we monitor for the respiratory rate, and this is possible by means of counting the respiration for 1 minute. Normally, the respiratory rate should be between 40 to 60 breaths per minute. At any time, if the respiratory rate is more than 60 breaths per minute, we would repeat for assessing the respiration for another 1 minute, ensuring that the baby is in a quiet state. The quantification of degree of respiratory status in a term newborn is done by means of Downey score. The Downey score is a bedside score which looks at 5 clinical parameters: the respiratory rate, the retractions, the cyanosis, the grunt, and the air entry. Based on each of these parameters, a score of 0, 1, or 2 is given. One would look at the trend of the scores and interpret the score taking into consideration the sensorium and the oxygen saturation to this sick newborn. In preterm babies, we would use the Silverman-Anderson score. Again, this score takes into consideration 5 bedside clinical parameters, that is chest movements, intercostal retraction, xiphoid retraction, nasal flaring, and expiratory grunt. A score of 0, 1, and 2 is given to each of these parameters based on the clinical status, and again, like in term newborns, a score of 7 or more indicates impending respiratory failure. Again, one would look at the trend of the score and interpret the score with sensorium and oxygen saturation in mind. All sick babies must have oxygen saturation being documented by means of pulse oximeter. The target oxygen saturation is 90 to 94%. Anytime, if the oxygen saturation in room air is less than 90%, we will call it as hypoxia. A low oxygen saturation, therefore, tells us that there could be an underlying problem secondary to a respiratory or a cardiac etiology. A normal oxygen saturation in a baby who appears dusky indicates a possibility of cold stress or an abnormal hemoglobin like methemoglobinemia. A labile oxygen saturation, by that we mean a fluctuating oxygen saturation, is a hallmark of pulmonary hypertension. At times, one would have a normal oxygen saturation in the upper limb and low oxygen saturation in the lower limb, what is called as differential hypoxia, which is classical of a shunt pathology or pulmonary hypertension. A fixed oxygen saturation not improving despite 100% oxygen tells us that we have refractory hypoxia, which is classical of a cyanotic heart disease or pulmonary hypertension. Mind you, for making the most of pulse oximeter, we must ensure that the baby is not cold, the baby is not in shock, and the baby is not agitated. For hypothermia, shock, and excessive movements of the limbs will come in the way of adequate interpretation of pulse oximeter values. It is equally important that all sick newborns must have a blood pressure being periodically monitored. The gold standard for blood pressure monitoring is invasive blood pressure. However, a non-invasive assessment by using the oscillometric blood pressure is also acceptable, for it is a surrogate marker for assessment of blood pressure. To optimize use of blood pressure, one must use appropriate size of cuffs, ensuring that the cuff width to the arm circumference is approximately 50%, so that too small a cuff or too loose a cuff will lead to an erroneous value, which must always be kept in the back of mind. It is equally important that we must look at multiple values of blood pressure rather than a single value while interpreting for blood pressure. Target blood pressure is approximately equal to the gestational age. What it means is, for example, a 30-week gestational baby should have a mean blood pressure of 30 millimeters of mercury. If it is low, then 30, we would say that the blood pressure is low for that baby. It is equally important that for assessing the circulatory status, we must in addition assess for skin perfusion, and that takes into consideration parameters like heart rate, respiratory rate, color, skin temperature, capillary refill time, urine output, sensorium, in addition to blood pressure. So, if we want to assess the adequacy of circulation, one must take into consideration all these parameters and not blood pressure in isolation, simply because hypotension is a late sign of shock. To pick up shock early, one would look at the signs of peripheral perfusion, and more the signs abnormal, more is the possibility of shock, and is important for us to pick up the shock in the early stage and not when the blood pressure stops dropping, for it will be too little and too late. The commonest metabolic problem of a sick newborn is hypoglycemia, and therefore all sick newborns must have sugar monitored. We must realize that there is no clinical sign which is pathognomic for hypoglycemia. What it means that hypoglycemia is a biochemical diagnosis. What is equally important is that we must have a periodic evaluation for all sick newborns to assess for sugar, and at any time, if the sugar is less than 40 milligrams per deciliter on the glucometer, one would start intervening for hypoglycemia, collecting a blood sample for blood sugar. It is equally important that not to miss a vital parameter in the form of urine output, for it tells us the adequacy of renal function. And the urine output is not in terms of wet nappies, for it is an approximation, but documentation of urine output by means of ml per kg per hour by using a plastic bag or a catheter. A urine output which is less than 1 cc per kg per hour tells us that it is oliguria, and a urine output more than 5 cc per kg per hour is polyuria. To summarize, clinical monitoring is the key, irrespective of underlying etiology and gestation of a baby. It starts with assessing the well-being by doing a rapid no-touch CBC. By that we mean consciousness, breathing, and color. following which we would assess for vital parameters, that is temperature, heart rate, respiration, blood pressure, urine output, oxygen saturation, and noting the baseline and any change from the baseline. In short, clinical monitoring is all about being meticulous, systematic, analytical, and comprehensive. Thank you very much.